Just taking a quick look at the test setup. I've got two multimeters which I've specifically calibrated for this test. They are probably at only about 1 millivolt apart in terms of the calibration that I did. One is measuring the voltage at the input to the USB monitor, and the other is measuring the voltage at the output, so we can see what the voltage drop across it is. I've then got this little adapter which I've gone and added a nice little port so I can have the USB coming in there. The wiring in here is very thick, so the input voltage is being measured off the tap over here. The output voltage is being measured over there. The Manuo electronic DC load is acting as the load. The Keithley is acting as a nice, precise, clean power supply for this exercise. To measure the current, I'm using Dave Jones's microcurrent. It's going to have less of an effect on the circuit. It's going to give us nice precise readings on the multimeter. I've got it on the downside again so that it doesn't affect the readings. And also, if I had it on the upside, it would be measuring the power or the current consumption of the device, which we don't want. We want to compare what this is measuring as a measurement flowing through the cable and not its own power consumption. So hence, it's on the downside of the device. Okay, first up is the Drock Mini. You're gonna have to excuse, there's a fair bit of balancing that's gone on to try and get everything into view without too much reflection, but hopefully we can see what's going on. Again, this is the input voltage, which as I dial the current up, because I'm not using current sense, there will be some drop across the cables. Ultimately, we're interested in seeing what the voltage difference is between the two, because that'll be the drop versus the input versus the output. Dave Jones's for the low current tests, I will use the microcurrent. I'm going to disconnect it for the high current tests. This in millivolts gives us an equivalent of 10.4 milliamp. So that's a direct reading into milliamp, which is being passed through the device at the moment. So if I come down to this device, I'm going to just demonstrate a couple of things. At the moment, we can see it's saying 4.99 for its resolution and the accuracy claim, which I think is around 1%. Certainly no issue there. There's about just over 5 volts going in. You can see it twitching. You can see it's got a power reading in watts, and the current is reading 0.01, so 10 milliamp. You can see it's just flickering there. But remember, this isn't built to have that resolution. You'll note the capacity setting is blinking. So what I'm going to do, just to demonstrate that, I'm going to dial up the current. So I'm at 100 milliamp, and you can see now it's gone steady. And it's so because it saw at least 1 milliamp hour pass through, it's gone and reset, and it's now totaling up a new setting. So that's how that operation works as I described it. We can see it's showing 0.1, flickering between 0.1 and 0.0. And if I come up here, we can see we're putting just over 100.3 milliamp into this device. The other quick feature I'll demonstrate on this Drock, which works on the other ones as well. I'm not going to change the voltage on the other ones, but if I dial up the voltage on this one is set so that once it reaches, I think, 5.3 volts, a little arrow will appear to show that you're perhaps at a high voltage. So that's just to give you a little warning. There we go. You can see that little blinking arrow in there in the video. And that's just to warn you that perhaps your USB voltage is just on the high side. Remember, this one I think can go up to 13 volts. I think the USB 3 version of this went up to about 13 volts. And then if we drop on the low side, I think around 4.7 volts if I remember correctly. There we go. As soon as you go below 4.7 volts, you can see there's a little low blinker. So that's just to indicate that perhaps if you're being conscious of your USB voltage levels, that'll just warn you that you're going perhaps below a certain voltage level on your USB port, which could potentially spell a few problems. So for this particular device, I'm not too concerned about its kind of level of measurements on current or what have you, because the resolution is so low. What we will just check is the voltage drop across it once we go up to a higher current. So this one, I've gone and disconnected the microcurrent. I'm going to disconnect the microcurrent for all the high current tests, so I don't damage that. And we're going to dial it up to about 2 amp. And if I come out, what I'm going to note is the voltage drop across it, just to see the effect that it has. So we can see we've got an input voltage of 4.9623, and out we get 4.7. So we got about a 0.2 or so drop of voltage, which I'll note. The other thing I am going to note is something I picked up on all these inline monitors, is that the voltage reading, there's obviously an error internally when it starts, when you've got higher current going through it because of the drop, and the actual reading on here versus what is going in is slightly out. So in fact, we've got 0.1 of a voltage error reading on the device versus what is actually going into the device. So that is measuring 4.87. And if we come out and have a look, we've actually got 4.96 at the input. And I have the USB 3 version of the Drock attached. So I've got it under no load at the moment. So if I pull out, you'll see it had a reading, or does have a reading, of 4.997 volts. And the input is under no load, is sitting at just over 5 volt. So there's a slight error there, but for the accuracy that's quoted, no problem with that. Next, we're going to switch on a 10 milliamp load. If we look very carefully, and this is after being reset, you can see it's saying about 7 or 8 milliamp. We've got about 10.4 milliamp flowing through it. I'm going to adjust that down to about 5 milliamp. So I say that about 5.8 milliamp we've got, and you can see it's reading 3. It does note in the specification, I think it's only above 3 milliamp that it starts reading. So I think once you get down here with the error, it starts going out. But I'm doing this because once we start getting down to the other devices, we should have an appreciation for how well they read at those lower current readings. I'm going to drop it down to 1 milliamp. That's about 1.7 milliamp. So I'm making the adjustment on the load, but we're certainly taking the load from Dave's microcurrent as being correct. And you can see it's got a reading of 0. So it's not picking that up. I'm going to go to 20 milliamp, just to give it something a bit more beefy to read. 20, we're actually getting about 20.8, and it is reading 18. So it's a couple of milliamp out. If I go up to 50 milliamp, again, still only a couple of milliamp out. We're at 50.9, so I certainly wouldn't complain about that. The next test will go to the 2 amp load and see how it performs. So I'll bring you out for a quick view before I adjust it out. We can see under no load at the moment, we're at 5 volts, basically in 5 volt out, 1 amp, 2 amp. So we're up to 2 amp. That is the voltage difference. I'll just bring you down to the device. We can see it's measuring 2.016, and I have got about on the DC load about 210. So again, it certainly seems to be reflecting a reasonably accurate current reading. The reading on the display here is saying 4.826. So again, that is just over 0.1 of a millivolt out. So I'm going to record that and then the difference between the input and the output. I've got the drop cable, as I call it, connected. No load, we're showing about 4.99 volt. If I pull you out, so that's just below. We can't really complain about the input voltage reading. We've got a 10 milliamp load, but this doesn't have the resolution to do that measurement. So we're not going to bother there. The next thing I'm going to do is take this up to the 2 amp. Or let me just take this up to 100 milliamp, just to make sure it does that measurement. So at 100 milliamp, we get the reading there. We can see 100 milliamp here. So that shows off all right. We've got the instantaneous power reading. And now we'll set up and jack it up to 2 amp to see what the readings are. 1, 2. So there's a fair voltage drop across there, and that's perhaps to be expected because we have got the cable. And then on the reading again, it's about 0.1 volt out on the reading. We've got 4.86 and 4.96 on the input, so I'll note those figures. Now we have the PortaPower Premium. I've got it set up under no load. I'll just put the backlight on, perhaps that's easier to read. But the voltage reading there, which goes down to 4 places, certainly we can't complain about that. It's probably a few millivolt out. I'm going to put a 10 milliamp load on. So we've got 10.5. It is showing 11.8. So it's a little bit out there. Let's take it up to something bigger. I've got up to 70 milliamp, and it's reading 72. a little bit out there, not too far. Take it up to 100. So we've got 100.8 and it's showing us 102.2. So it's a little bit out there. So the next thing we're going to do is drop it down to perhaps something low. Let's see how low this one can go. So if we go down to 5 milliamp, it's reading 7.3. We've got 5.8, so it's a little bit out there. This one, of course, you cannot calibrate if you do have an error. Let's go down to 3.8. So there we go. You can see it's showing 5, and if I drop 1 milliamp, it goes to 0. So this cannot really measure really low current. We'll see how it performs now on the 2 amp scale. All right, so now we're ready for the 2 amp test. 1 amp on. So we've got 2 amp, it's measuring just over 2 amp. It's measuring 4.87, and this is 4.96. So I wonder if that's because we're consistently getting a 0.1 voltage drop in the readings, whether that's to do with even literally between the cabling inside here going out to the port. Could be. Obviously this has got a bit more wiring on it, but I'll just note it. So I'll note that reading, and then we'll also note the voltage drop. So we've got 4.96 versus 4.7. Now we at the USB 3 power monitor. That's the YZX Studio. This is one that Frankie Tong sells. There is no load, so it is measuring what, almost 5 volt exactly. It's twitching on the end. I do know apparently that the firmware update helps stabilize the reading instead of it twitching around, as I recall. But that is reading almost spot on 5 volts, and if we come out, obviously that is roughly what we've got at the input. I've not done any calibration on this one. I've only done calibration on the yellow one. So let's put a load on. We'll start off with just over 10 milliamps, so 10.06. And if we have a look at that, that is showing 10.7. Sometimes flicking to 10.9, because of its resolution, we're really getting a nice resolution there, and it is showing spot on, and that is without any calibration. Let's just dial it up to say I've got it on 60, so we've got 60.9 or 60.8, and look, that's virtually exactly what it is showing on the display. I'll just bring you in a little bit closer. So there's a 60.9, there's a 60.9 there, a slight little flutter. But again, these just amaze me that you get the accuracy and resolution down to that level. We'll go down to the 10 again. So we've got 10.6, it's showing 10.7, sometimes fluttering to 10.9. Now let's go lower. I'm down to 2.8, it is showing 2.9. I've gone down to 1.8, it is showing flicking between 1.9 and 2.1. And believe it or not, I can't go lower on my electronic DC load. This is showing about 1.3, 1.4, and that is showing about 1.3, 1.5 milliamp. So that is the brilliant thing about these devices. They can go show you really high resolution, great accuracy. The others cannot go nearly that level, and they're certainly not showing that level of accuracy. Right, so I'm ready to perform the 2 amp test. I'm just going to switch it on at 0, take it up to 2 amp. And if we have a look at the device, we can see it is showing 2 amp. The reading is 4.82, we've got 4.96, so again slightly out, and then we've got the voltage difference, so there's roughly 0.3 volt difference there. I'll note those and we'll do a comparison at the end. This is the YZX Studio, the yellow model. This, I'm going to be honest, this is one of my favorite models. I really like the interface and the functionality of this one. So that is showing 5.002.3. It's bouncing around a little bit at the end. As I said, this one would need a firmware update, and the current shunt in here, in fact, should be updated. But let me just pull back. So we've got that 5.001 coming in, certainly not far off what it's displaying. We'll put on the 10, we've got 10.6 milliamp. This is showing 10.7. So there we go, the 10.7 versus the 10.6. We'll just take it up to, I've got just over, just on about 51. This is showing 51.2. This is showing 51.06. So not far, certainly very close within ball hairs. Take it up to 100. We've got 100.9. This is showing 101. A smidgen. So slightly out. But again, just going down to four places, that resolution and the accuracy, I'm always impressed by these ones. Let's see what I can do on the low end. So I've gone down to about 4.9. It is showing 4.9. I'm down to about 1.8. This is showing 1.9 milliamp. I think that's almost the lowest that I can go to. No, so 0.86. So call it 0.9. And that is what we're showing, 0.9. So this one, on the other one, was slightly out. I did do a calibration on this one prior to starting, and that's the beauty about these units, is that you can calibrate them, and it certainly works. Let's do the 2-amp test. Okay, I'm just gonna dial in 1 amp. We've got 1 amp displayed. We've got a slight voltage drop. We go up to 2 amp. And again, it's about 0.1 volt out on the reading. So we've got 4.96, we've got 4.87 that it's bouncing around with on that display. So again, roughly about a 0.1 volt drop on the display. And again, so I'm not 100% sure whether that's happening internally on these or whether my wiring in between here and here is playing a part, but I'll just record that. I'll note these figures and we'll look at all of them together. Okay, so let's see if we can round that up quickly. Taking a look at the YZX Studio, so that's the one that Frankie Tong sells, the red version, that goes for about $30. The error on the reading, and again, in fact, I'm going to ignore the error on the reading. It's either, say, slightly internally on the device or that wiring that I had. All of them had roughly around, as you can see, about 0.1 volt, between 0.09 or 0.14. The voltage drop against that one when it was at 2 amp was 0.292. I'll note that the one I don't have here, which he calls the black, which is the same as this, so it's got the same functionality as this one, except it's got an 18-bit analog to digital converter, so it measures voltage down to four places. That one, apparently, I think, does have lower resistance, so that might have a lower drop. But that one was 0.292, the yellow version was 0.248. The porter power was 0.246, which actually isn't too bad because there was, it did have its own external cabling. The Drock cable version, so that's this one over here, that one was 0.393. So there's a bit of a drop there, obviously because of the cabling which is being used on it. The Drock Mini was 0.25, and then the Drock USB 3 is 0.24. So I suppose much of a muchness, if I personally was going to throw my money anywhere, for one, I'm intrigued to see this USB 2 version that Frankie sells that gives the better voltage resolution and might have a slightly better voltage drop. But mine, I really, for the money, for that $33, I really like the yellow version just because it's got that capability to set it to fast charge. So if you've got an iPad in particular and you want to get the high current out, then for me, that is personally the one that I would go for. Certainly for the price range, the Drocks, for the lower price ones, if you're just wanting to do a quick check, the Drock Mini at just over $14 and the cable at $17.98, those are good options. I mean, if you're looking at the price point between this porter power and the Drock cable, definitely the Drock cable. This one, for the price and the reliability, not a good idea. But the Drock USB 3, if you consider the specifications that it doesn't have the voltage range or the accuracy or the ability to both calibrate both current and voltage versus, let's say, the YZX Studio, the yellow version. This is at $33, this is at $40. So again, I know where I'd put my money. So there we go. I hope you found that of value. I'm going to have links below to all of the meters I tested. Some of them will be on my Amazon store. I'll provide links to the website, and also I'll provide links to Frankie's, which are on his eBay store. A big thanks to Frankie for supplying them to me. Thanks to Drock or D-Rock, who supplied me one of their meters as well. If you gain any value from this review, please give it a thumbs up, and I'll catch you soon for the next one. Cheers.